Good job.
All right, folks. Several years ago at a meeting of biblical scholars, well-known Bible translator Eugene Nida mentioned that in his vast experience among various peoples of the world, the one New Testament document that caused the most trouble for translators was the gospel called John. For even though John's vocabulary and syntax are simpler than other New Testament writings like Hebrews and Luke, professional translators have difficulty in articulating in the various languages of the world exactly what John meant. Perhaps this holds for our current English translations as well. Why this state of affairs? Could it be that the Gospel of John derives from a social system atypical even in the first century Eastern Mediterranean? Consider some of the peculiar features of the Gospel called John. Perhaps the most direct way to approach John is to note its author's distinctive development of and penchant for new phrases in place of old ones, for many words for the same activity. For example, when you're reading Paul, and Paul talks about faith in Christ Jesus, when Paul speaks of faith in Christ Jesus, when he does that when he wants to speak about faith in Christ Jesus. When Paul wants to talk about faith in Christ Jesus, he talks about faith in Christ Jesus. Like in Galatians 2, verse 16. A person is not justified by works of the law, but through faith, loyalty in Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Christ Jesus, that we may be justified by faith, loyalty in Christ, and not by works of the law, because by works of the law, no one will be justified. Paul speaks about faith in Christ Jesus when he wants to speak about faith in Christ Jesus. Not John. John speaks about believing into Jesus. What? And to express this reality, believing into Jesus, John has recourse to such terms as following Jesus, abiding in Jesus, loving Jesus, keeping Jesus' word, receiving Jesus, having Jesus, or seeing Jesus. Think about that. What does following Jesus mean to you? Maybe doing something moral or walking in Jesus' way of love, loving God and neighbor, right? Maybe something like that. Yes. That's what it means to you.
Yes.
I'm not saying that's bad or wrong. Is that what it meant to John? What does abiding in Jesus mean to you? What does that mean?
Believing in him.
Okay. What does loving Jesus mean to you? And why doesn't John just say, believe in Jesus?
Like
John doesn't do that, huh?
Be like him.
Be like him.
Try to get to know him.
Loving Jesus, that's what that means?
Spending time with him.
But is he making sense to those he's addressing?
Oh, absolutely.
Well, then that's
they all get it.
That's where it's at.
But to outsiders of his group, they wouldn't get it. They would find his language secretive, strange, and esoteric.
So then he's not as out of space as everyone thinks he is, because
everybody in his community is out of space, in outer space. That's the problem.
But the people,
even compared to the other Jesus groups.
I know, but he was addressing, they understood him.
Sure. But that tells you something about who he is and what he's about. What does keeping Jesus' word mean to you? Or receiving Jesus mean to you? Whatever that means, it means something different than what it means to John. What does having Jesus mean to you? Or seeing Jesus mean to you?
Building a stronger bond.
Building a stronger bond. Well, that might actually be kind of close. You look at all those verbs. Following Jesus, abiding in Jesus, loving Jesus, keeping Jesus' word, receiving Jesus, having Jesus, and seeing Jesus. You look at those words, you might think, okay, well, that's a development. That those things all are different directions. They're maybe related to the same thing, but they're all specifically and different. They're all different, and they talk about different ways we relate to Jesus. Yeah, well, while those verbs express different facets of behavior for us, not so for John. For John, they're all the same thing, believing into Jesus. All these words are the same thing. They're not going anyplace. This language isn't developing anything. It's just many different ways of expressing the same concept. For John, all these expressions and words describe believing into Jesus.
But don't we practice the same thing in our modern time? We have one word that can have different meanings.
Sure. Sure. But here he has many words that have that mean one meaning. It's the reverse in John. The same is true for John's selection of words that refer to the realm of God. When he talks about spirit or above or life or light, not of this world or not of the world, freedom, truth, love, all he's talking about is the realm of God. Many words to describe one reality. This feature bespeaks language partially relexicalized. What does that mean? John uses too many words and expressions for expressing the same thing. Too many. To follow Jesus for John means to stay in Jesus. Now, if I said to stay in Jesus and to follow Jesus, you might see that they're related, but you wouldn't say they're the same thing.
No.
But John would. Both those expressions mean to believe into Jesus. For John.
For them, it was okay how they spoke.
Sure. But the problem, Rose, is we're reading our development on miscues of having these expressions for us meaning different things, but maybe we're not getting what he originally meant. So let's try to go back to what he meant. You see, these words, all these expressions, seeing Jesus, abiding in Jesus, following Jesus, keeping his word, they don't go any place. They don't expand. The meaning is the same, believing into Jesus.
How do we determine that?
We're getting there. That's a great question, Mary. How do we determine that? You're going to see. If you were part of the Johannine Jesus group, as Rose is talking about, you would understand this language. But if you were not and you heard it, it would seem strange to you, bizarre. Indeed, for an outsider to the Johannine Jesus group reading its gospel or hearing it, the text would seem esoteric. John employs an insider language, a secret language. The style of John is so repetitive that it seems to go round and around and around in circles. And that's exactly what it's doing. The author seems to say the same thing over and over and over again, often using the same words. The significance of this kind of language escapes many modern readers of John. Few realize that this repetition and using of too many words and expressions to express the same thing is anti-language. Peculiar to an anti-society, such as the community of John. Vidi well, little brother, vidi well. The basic purpose of such anti-language is not to communicate ideas, but rather to imbue interpersonal relationships with ever-deepening emotional anchoring.
In other words, what we see it with, what we put into it,
is off, because what we're doing, Rose, is we're looking at it as little gems, and it is gems, And we're trying, okay, walking, John tells us to follow Jesus. So how am I going to do that? Well, that must be, you know, I'm going to do something morally in the world today. Which, by the way, that's not wrong. Spiritually, that's fine. I think that's great. But that's not really what John was talking about. John doesn't imagine this being a guide for ethics for the rest of, you know, 2,000 years, what he's writing. You get what I'm saying to you?
He's writing for that time.
He's writing for a specific community that's very different from the other communities of Jesus at that time. And you got to get this.
Were they outcasts?
Oh, we're going to talk about that. Yeah, why? Great. Why would you say that? That's fascinating, Rose. Why would you say that? Because of the way they talk? They have their own little secret language, like in their secret clubhouse, and they talk in a certain way? That's interesting. Dandy.
When I first started reading the Bible, I knew it was John because he always said, amen, amen.
Yeah.
And I'm like, why did Jesus say that?
Yeah, he does. In fact, that's something that he shares with the synoptics, although the synoptics usually puts it in a little bit different. Yeah, but yeah, verily, verily, the way it's translated. But amen, amen, yeah, Jesus is binding himself by oath big time. Saying, if what I'm saying isn't true, you can trust in this because I put a curse on myself if it's not true.
But right now, in our time, we see John, this John, as John the Baptist, John the disciple.
Yeah.
The one they call John the Dunker.
But in the text, it never says, this is John. It never gives his name. It's the other disciple, the one Jesus loved. And what does love mean? We got to talk about that. We got to talk about that. Doesn't mean what American 21st century introspective people mean. Sorry. We're going to talk about that. All right. Anti-society and anti-language. Relexicalization refers to the practice of using new words for some reality that is not ordinarily referred to with those words. To call money bread or to call a pistol a piece are instances of relexicalization that you're familiar with, aren't you? Mm-hmm. How much bread you got? Well, $50. The implicit principle behind relexicalization seems to be this. Same grammar, but different vocabulary, though only in certain key areas. Same grammar, different vocabulary. Relexicalization points to items and objects affecting areas of central concern to the group. John's relexicalizations derive from the interests and activities of the Johannine Jesus group. In John, this concern is articulated as follows. The central concern, John chapter 20, verse 31, that you, whoever you is, may continue to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. That's his central concern. In other words, the author of John is concerned with spelling out the meaning of Jesus of Nazareth as the Messiah, the Son of God, and in developing emotional anchorage into Jesus for his collectivity, his Jesus group. It is to this end that the author, we call John, develops his very different anti-language vocabulary. Furthermore, John does not simply relexicalize in his area of concern. He over-lexicalizes. He uses way too many words to express the same thing. To over-lexicalize is to have too many words for the central area of concern. John, you got too many words in here. And they don't go anyplace. They just say the same thing over and over again. It's like crabgrass. You ever have crabgrass when you're mowing the lawn? Huh? Go ahead, what were you going
to
say, Mary?
He wants to cover all bases. He wants to leave no questions.
But his idea is, but he doesn't want to expand anywhere. He's just saying the same thing over and over and over again.
Well, Like a prayer.
Kind of like that. Yes, like a prayer.
I guess he wants to...
But let's not bring Madonna into this. No, go ahead.
He wants to make sure the message gets home.
Yeah. To the people already in the home. Because
yeah.
It's not people outside the home he's writing for. Mm-mm. They wouldn't get it.
A question.
Yes.
Okay. John, okay. Right now, no one really knows John whom.
Well, we're going to write in this class, right? We're going to talk about it. We're going to see if we can develop that.
And
okay.
Why is it the gospel?
Well, we'll get there. We'll get there, Rose. That's great. We'll get there. It was included. It was included in the canon. In John's gospel, the author employs a broad range of vocabulary words and phrases to cover a single area, as we've noted. First, there is his comparisons and contrast between opposites, between spirit and flesh.
Parallels, cultism.
Parallel cultism? Interesting. Let's look at that. Maybe there cults do happen to use dualistic, you know, extremes sometimes.
Yep.
I wouldn't necessarily call John's group something negative like cult in the modern sense of the word, which has a very negative connotation. But anyway, there are these comparisons he keeps giving: contrast between opposites, spirit and flesh, between above and below, between life and death, between light and darkness. Between not of the world or not of this world, and of this world or of the world. Between freedom and slavery. Between truth and lies. Between love and hate. These two sets of words are variants used to describe contrasting spheres of existence, opposing modes of living and being. Look at all that vocabulary. All those comparisons. All it means is a comparison and a contrast between those in the Johannine Jesus group, the insiders, and the outsiders. That's all it means. That's all he's talking about. There are a whole set of comparisons and contrasts that are unique to John, used to describe people who belong to his in-group and all outsiders. The in-group is the Johannine Jesus group, the Johannine community. The in-group is attuned to the above. It breathes spirit. It has life, and it follows God. But the out-group has no spirit, has death, is open to death. It follows the devil. There is no appreciable difference in the significance of these words, ladies and gentlemen. The one exception being to characterize one group from the other group. Insiders from outsiders. That's why he goes on and on and on with it. Because you see what his central concern is. He's very concerned with this group sticking together and apart from the outside.
Well, who's he to say that the outsiders...
Uh-oh! That's a great question. We'd be really in trouble if all we had for a gospel was John. We may never have come out of the catacombs and built hospitals and universities if it was only the Johannine theology that we had. Yes, Rose, there are problems with Christ versus culture models taken to an extreme.
As it's done today.
As it's done today, sure. Similarly, and with very little appreciable difference in meaning, John speaks about believing into Jesus. Following Jesus, abiding in Jesus, loving Jesus, keeping his word, receiving Jesus, having Jesus, or seeing Jesus. This kind of redundancy is what we mean by over-lexicalization. Too many words to say the same thing. Sociolinguists in the Neo-Firthian tradition tell us that languages entail three linguistic modes of meaning. The ideational, the interpersonal, and the textual. The ideational refers to what is being said or described. The ideational refers to what is being said or described. The interpersonal looks to the personal qualities of the communicating partners. And the textual pertains to the qualities of language to form units of meaning at a level higher than the sentence, for example, by means of cohesion of paragraphs into some whole text. So there you go, the ideational, the interpersonal, and the textual. The handouts that I gave you have these defined at the top. You need to take these handouts home. When you leave, please don't leave them. Take them home and look them over, because that's how we'll get it and we'll understand this. So once more, okay? What one says is ideational. What one says is ideational. With whom one speaks is interpersonal. With whom one communicates is interpersonal. And how one speaks or writes or communicates is textual. We got that? All right, ideational, interpersonal, and textual. Okay. We single out these three components here because John typically de-emphasizes the ideational, what he has to say. That's very much unlike Mark, Matthew, and Luke. Huge difference. Huge difference from Paul, too. Their focus is the ideational. What one has to say matters a lot. But for John, doesn't matter that much. John focuses rather heavily on the interpersonal, with whom the conversation occurs, and the textual, how one speaks. That's his concern. Mark, Matthew, Luke, and Paul, they de-emphasize the textual and the interpersonal. What is said is more important than how it is said and with whom it is said. For Paul and the synoptics. There's a little bit of it all in all of them, but now where's the focus? And I'm trying to show you how different John is. It's very different. See, the ideational's at the bottom, tiny. So if we made a comparison of the text of John, the whole gospel as a written text, with the synoptic gospels, Mark, Matthew, and Luke, it will readily indicate to you that John downplays the ideational feature of language.
He leaves out all the birth narratives and the infancy narratives.
That's another thing, but yes, I would say he's not giving you what he says is really contained in the first 18 verses. Anything new he has to say, it's those 18 verses. And everything else that follows those 18 verses is just crabgrass. Just going, it's just all the stories and all the signs and the passion narrative and everything is just the development. It's just saying the same thing over and over again. It's not expanding it. It's the same thing over and over and over again. I don't mean to make it sound boring to you. It's not. But when it's fascinating, John. Fascinating. But when you begin to see it, you begin to go, oh my God, the whole thing he has to tell me is contained in the first 18 verses? And there's nothing new after that? Everything after that is the same thing over and over and over and over and over again, just developed. Not developed in terms of expanded, I mean, just restated in different words and in different ways.
Was the author afraid of this group hearing from the outsiders, and that's why it was being redundant?
I don't know. I don't know about that. He definitely wants to have a cohesive whole. So are we ready to